Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is The Loving Use of Mediumship and is part of the Spirit Relationship series. It was presented in Kentucky, New South Wales, Australia on the 7th of April 2012. This is Session 1, Part 1.
How are you today?
Excited.
What is the time?
Is it 1 o'clock?
So just after 1 or 1? Okay. Now I think we're going to be right with the mics. It sounds clear. It's like not going to ring. So it's good. All right. Okay. We're training people in Kyabra to do recording and sound and everything else, and it's working pretty well. And the reason for that is that eventually we'd like everyone down here to be totally self-sufficient with the sound and the video and even producing videos as well. So we're sort of setting all of that up, and the Lytton-Hitchins family has bought a lot of equipment to allow for that to happen. So that's what we're doing. Okay. Well, today, should we just cover some mundane issues first,
yeah.
And then we'll get into what we're going to do today.
Yep.
So the mundane issues are basically what we're planning to do this week. We'll just tell you a bit of what we're planning to do this week. Mary and I are going to stay around at least till Wednesday and possibly longer. And so on Wednesday, Mary is going to do a book group here rather than a book group up in Queensland. So those of you who know that Mary's doing a book group with regard to Through the Mists, we're up to chapter 4.
Yep.
And if you'd like to come along and discuss that book, Mary can give you the details of what you need to do to come along.
Okay. So you need to have read chapters 1 to 4. And on my blog, there's a list of questions, like they're study questions that you answer in relation to each chapter. So it would be really great if you've answered the questions in relation to each chapter.
So what's the address of your blog?
It's www.magdalena-mary.blogspot.com. But you can get to it via the Divine Truth website. If you go to, on the sidebar, I think there's Mary, About Mary or something, and one of the drop-downs is Mary's blog. So if you go straight across to there, there's a static page, if you look on the top bars of the blog, that says book group info. If you click on that, it tells you lots of details about the book group, including the study questions to answer for each chapter. Also, on YouTube, there are the recordings of the first 3 talks that we held in Queensland. So it's up to you if you want to watch them. I feel that it would give you a more fuller understanding of where we're at in terms of our reflections in Queensland. But it's not absolutely obligatory that you've watched all of those. Just that you have completed the study questions, because that's what we're going to talk about in the meeting, is your reflections on the book up to chapter 4. So I'd love to have you along if you'd like to come. So.
Yep. I think that's the main thing that we'd probably like to mention, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sticking around.
Yeah.
So today, what we're planning to talk about today is the subject of... sorry, David, you have a question? Just have the mic. Let's wait for it.
Mary, you mentioned something about mediumship nights on your blog.
Yes, we're probably going to be here for Thursday night mediumship this week. So that's an already scheduled event that the mediumship team here had planned.
Yep.
So, yep.
Okay.
So, and as AJ's about to say, the topic of today's talk is on mediumship as well. So, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Thanks.
All right. Yeah, so the topic of today's talk is spirit relationships. That's the main heading. And then the sub point is...
loving you.
Well, I had it perfectly yesterday, didn't I? It was actually about the loving use of mediumship. So it's going to be called the loving use of mediumship. So that's what we wanted to discuss with you today. But instead of just giving you sort of a talk about it, we're going to handle it a bit differently. What we're going to do, and the reason why Peter is up and Mary are up with me, is Peter is going to give you, he's going to channel a spirit. The spirit's name is Angelo, who some of you have already met. But Angelo is going to give you a bit of background about himself and let you get to know him a little first. And then Mary is going to channel two spirits who are a soulmate couple in the spirit world. Their names are Rachel and Timothy, and they used to be with us in the first century as well. So they'll give you a bit of background about themselves. So what we want to do firstly is get to know the spirits that we're speaking to. Once we know them, and you can ask them some questions during this process if you wish as well. Once we get to know them, the three of us, and when I say the three of us, basically Peter and Mary are going to channel. So there will actually be four people speaking to you about the subject of the loving use of mediumship. There'll be Angelo speaking to you about it. There'll be, for Mary, there'll be Timothy and Rachel speaking to you about it, and then I'll add my two bobs worth in occasionally as well. Does that make sense? So instead of giving a talk where just I'm giving the talk, it'll be a shared talk between three spirits and myself. So that's how we're going to handle today's discussion.
And so Peter and Mary are a bit nervous about getting out of the way.
Do you mind sharing some of the stuff that I've got with Angelo? Like, because I think that's quite appropriate for everyone down
certainly
here.
Certainly.
So experienced Angelo.
So what we've attempted to do is talk to Peter about truly reflecting Angelo's personality to you. Because Angelo is actually a flamboyant Italian. Right? And Peter is not a flamboyant Italian, as you know. So one of the things that is difficult for Peter to do is to reflect the actual personality of the spirit Angelo. And so what we've tried to encourage Peter to do is to sort of allow himself to be the flamboyant Italian that is going to be channeling
through. I'm wearing white. That's Angelo's favourite colour. So that's a start.
That's a start. The other problem that many people who come from natural love type of areas with regard to channeling is they often, the spirits who are natural love spirits often have this imposition that they place upon people who channel natural love spirits. And the imposition they place is that you've got to honour them all the time and you've got to put them in a bit of a higher position than yourself. And so what's happened historically for the Lytton-Hitchins family is that they have all had this tendency, they all can channel, but they've all had the tendency to put the spirit into a higher position and then to become a little rigid and formal with regard to the channeling that those spirits do. Now, while that might be suitable for a person who's on the natural love path and who believes himself to be higher than you, the people on the divine love path, and particularly the ones who have become celestial spirits, they don't believe themselves to be higher than you. They just feel that they're your brothers and sisters and they just try to be themselves. And so while it's okay perhaps to channel natural love spirits in that way, channeling spirits who are on the divine love path, often those spirits on the divine love path want you to be more informal and realistic. So what we've asked Peter to do is just allow himself to relax and let himself be this flamboyant Italian and allow himself to also relax with the formality. For Mary and for Peter, there has often been difficulties channeling information that is related to specific things that could affect your life where you make a choice or a decision and then go on a different path. And so they are sometimes very worried about channeling something that you then change your life about. So there's that emotion that's affected the channeling. There's also the emotion sometimes of they're a little afraid of making you angry, whereas our celestial spirit friends are not afraid of making you angry at all. Does that make sense? So because of that fear, there's sometimes the resistance to being more open about the truth. And for Mary, there is often the emotions related to her own life with the spirits. Does that make sense? So her life with the spirits, our life with the spirits in the first century, were quite, I suppose you could say, our life was quite close with them, so we know them well, but there's also quite a lot of emotions that we have about our experiences with those particular people that Mary has yet to release. And so sometimes she gets a bit teary when they start speaking about their life and so forth and our involvement in their life. And that, of course, causes the communication also to suffer a little in terms of its accuracy. So what we did last night is we talked together about these particular things and tried to address some of the emotions so that today we could have a fairly open discussion with you, with three spirits and myself, about the discussion and the discussion about the loving use of mediumship. Does that make sense?
Yeah. There's also one other thing that affects me a lot, channeling my guides, and I'm sure it's relevant for a lot of you, just in having a relationship with your guides, and that is the amount of love that they have for each of us. And often I find that's very emotional to open up to receiving that amount of love. It triggers a lot of grief in me. So that's another thing that comes up for me that is also relevant for you guys, I feel. So.
Okay.
And just for myself, like after our conversation last night, you know, the first thing I say to Angela this morning is like, Angela, you got to give me the heads up here. What are we going to talk about today? I wanted the final details, and Angela's like, you don't need to know anything.
Rachel did exactly the same thing with me. She said, you don't need to prepare. It's my story. Could you just tell me the details?
It's like a game of football, you know, like you get all stressed and whatever. And it's like, it needs to be where you don't even, literally, it's just another day, and it's like,
yeah.
And I still have all these fears that come up about accuracy and about, you know, the intent and stuff like that.
So the only one sitting here that needs to be worried about what he's saying is myself, because I'm not channeling anybody. and the two next to me need to just stay in this space of accurately channeling the information as best they're able. So that's what we're hoping to do today. Now, in that process, we're hoping also that you can start to see the character and nature of the spirits that surround us at different times. And with regard to these three spirits, they are all celestial spirits, so we hopefully will be able to demonstrate to you to a bit larger degree the true character and nature of a celestial spirit, rather than feeling all formal and all worried about what's really going on with our spirit friends. So that's what we're going to do today. So the first thing that we wanted to do is to introduce you to them in a manner where they tell a bit of their story about their life and when they lived on Earth, what happened to them while they were living on Earth, when they died or what happened to them when they passed, when they arrived in the spirit world, how they felt, what happened to them during their development in the spirit world, when they met their soulmates and all those kind of issues, so that you get a bit of a picture about their life and also a bit of a picture about their character. And now during this process, feel free to ask them questions about their life. Does that make sense? That come up for you. So don't be afraid to ask questions, but if we can microphone the questions. So. Where is Laura? There's the microphone there. So the microphone will just need to be passed around. So if you do ask a question and you point it out, please just wait for the microphone to come so that we can actually record your question. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay. Well, who do you want to start with first? Would you like to know Angelo more, or would you like to know Rachel and Timothy first? Who would you like to start with? What's the general feeling? I want to start with Angelo. Okay, so where we go?
It was going to happen, wasn't it?
We'll start with Angelo first. Where's the family of Angelo? I can't tell you. No, that's all right.
You can't pigeonhole it,
no,
Angelo.
No, no, no.
Finally. It's taken a while. Buongiorno, anyway.
Buongiorno.
Yes. My life was very ordinary. You see, celestials have having grandeur in their life. My life on earth was very simple. My father was a fisherman. And you were either a boy or you were a man. There was no in between. And so for me, I was with my mother till I was 5 years old. And then I was a man with my father. He fished. And any of you have been fishing? The smell of fish. I did not like the smell of fish. So, one day in my village, I saw the most grand boat I'd ever seen. I was 15, and this boat was a merchant boat. It had beautiful smells. This man knows beautiful smells. The smells that I had never smelt before, and they certainly weren't fish. So I say to my father, my time fishing is done. No more fishing, I am done. My mother, she was just a mother, so she fed us and looked after us. That's how we saw our mothers. We didn't see them any other way. We had to become men as soon as possible. So I just said goodbye to my mother. I am going on this boat. This man, who was the captain of the boat, his name, Roberto. And Roberto was the first father I had ever had. For the next 5 years, he took me all around the Mediterranean Sea. We traded here and we traded there. But what I remember most about Roberto is he taught me about stars. He taught me how to feel the ocean. These days, a captain does not know how to feel the ocean. In our day, it was 1626 when I was born. So 1636, when I first really started learning the sea, and by 1640, it was very dangerous times in the Mediterranean Sea. So Roberto was a true seaman, a true captain. He went where no other boats went. He understood the coral reefs. He understood when it was going to rain. But he taught me the stars. And I think the stars were the most beautiful thing he taught. Then, just when I felt my life was perfect and that this was always going to be the way, one morning I went into his cabin and I'd never seen a dead person before. And here was my father, who I saw as my father, and he looked the most ugly sight I'd ever seen. His jaw was open. His eyes were wide open. And I did not know what to do. He was the first man I loved. And I didn't know how to cry. And so, it was the most difficult, but one of the most important times in my life. I remember grabbing a sheet and wrapping up this dead thing who had once been so much to me. And I could not work out how the feelings I had to this man were no longer in this thing before me. It took me another 5 years to shed a tear for the greatest friend I ever had. Why I was on earth. Anyway, his will was read on the boat, and then they said, this boat and all his belongings now belong to Angelo Rimbardi. And then suddenly a man clapped me on the shoulder and said, well done, son. And I said, what do you mean? And he said, this is all yours. And I was horrified. Roberto had given me his boat and all his possessions. So for the next 5 years, I was terrified. So instead of trading large quantities, we traded little routes. I did little short trips, no big trips. And then one day, we were near Morocco, and I was in trouble. I had a man come up to me and say, one of our Portuguese boats has gone down, and we need your boat. This was no ordinary man. He was not asking me. He was telling me. And I said, so what are we doing? He said, you do not need to know. All you need to do is follow those three boats over there. And you have an order to supply. And you will be paid more money than you have ever paid. So the amount was like 1 year's work for a few months. So we arrived at the port, and I still had no idea. And then suddenly it dawned upon me when I saw all these men in chains, one after the other. They were chained at the hands and chained at the feet. And some of them even had neck collars going from one to the other. Most of them, their eyes. I always remember their eyes. So they came on my boat, 326 of them, where normally only 10 men used to live. 326 slaves were now on my boat. We had to sail for 2.5 months. The smell, you know how I didn't like fish smell. This smell was so much different. And I remember there was this one man that came on the boat. And this is probably one of the most important parts of my whole life that I did not know at the time. He came on the boat, and he had these scabs on his feet and his hands and his neck, and especially on his chest. They were like big welts, pussy welts. I had nowhere to put this man, so I put him on my bed. That was the only place that I felt was okay. I couldn't put him in my men's quarters. So from that moment onwards, he stayed in my quarters, and we treated him the best we could, but it wasn't very good. And then when we finally got to our destination, this man was walked off the boat with all the rest. I did not even know his name. I did not even know his name. Then I arrived home to my wife. I had only been married for a short time. And it was the one and only time that I ever cried on earth. And I cried and promised myself that I would never jump on a boat again. And from that moment onwards, I no longer sailed the sea. From that moment on, the rest of my life was very ordinary. But the most important part of this story is when I passed. Who do you think was the first person I saw when I passed? This slave who had been on my bed was the man who introduced me to my new life. This man. He's even more beautiful now than he was then. That's my introduction.
So should we ask the audience whether they'd like to ask you some questions?
They can.
What would you like to ask, Angelo? Come down to the inner, down the front here.
What condition did you pass in when you died?
Well, I was an ordinary man who did ordinary things. So my condition was not bright, but it was not dark. So when I went, I could feel my body, and I knew that I had moved from earth to another space. So I was never earthbound. Then when I arrived, it was a state of curiosity of what this place was like. I was not a religious man. See, if you were a religious man back then and you were sailing a boat, you saw so many people who believed in God who didn't survive the sea. So my curiosity was more after factual information. So when my body arrived in the spirit world, I would be what you would call in the first fear state. I was open, but I had not been loving to my wife. I had not cared for many things. And I certainly didn't understand many things.
Angela, can I ask you a question?
I wonder what changed for you after you entered the spirit world. Obviously now you have a strong desire for God. What changed for you?
Well, I blame things that happen in my life on those around them rather than realizing that it was my opportunity to do whatever I wanted to do. When I was a child, I felt that I had to be a fisherman. Then when I realized I didn't have to be a fisherman, that was the first time in my life on earth that there was a change. When I got to the spirit world, my greatest opportunity was the first time I met this slave that had been with me. Because he showed me that there was compassion and there was love in the spirit world. And I was not expecting that. And then by asking him how he could love after what had happened to him, that was the beginning of my journey. He had so much love for me, and I felt I hadn't done enough to help him. Mm-hmm. When he had died 3 days after he had arrived at shore, after being on my boat. Mm. And yet, when I arrived in the spirit world, he was there as if the most gracious friend I had ever met.
Thank you.
Hi, Angelo. It's nice to see you without Peter in the way.
I just told him to relax.
Peter. I've been wondering about this whole process of like when we end up doing things like what you felt you had to do of carrying all those slaves, and a part of you obviously knew it was wrong. Mm. And a part of you felt, obviously, probably that you had to go along with it.
Well, it's not that I had to go along with it.
Yeah, so that whole process.
The question I have for all of you is this word about death. I've been talking to Peter lots about this word. There is a belief that there's this separation between this life and the next life. If I had arrived at that point, and this man had said to me that you are carrying slaves on your boat, if I realized in that moment that if I said no, that I would not die, I probably would have said no. If I believed that. Because in that state, we're simply going from one place to another. Our journey does not stop. I know that now.
So what you're saying is that if you realised that you could have just said no, he probably would have murdered you.
He would have killed me, but that would have been okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm.
And I would have been in a second or third sphere space when I went.
So you could, I guess you could really feel the impact it had on your soul to go along with it. Is that?
We feel that we can't make choices when we live on earth.
Yeah.
And this is one of the greatest false beliefs that many of you have, that you can't make the choice. You are constantly making a choice every second of every day. And it's your choice, regardless of who influences that choice. Right. It's your choice, just like it was my choice.
And if you made a choice to honour the truth and honour love, you might have passed immediately, but you would have passed into a far better condition because you had made the choice because you feared death.
Yes.
You made a different choice, and then, of course, when you did eventually pass, you passed into a worse condition.
And this fear of death went through my whole life, because we make decisions from that moment onwards related to that. So I used to love sailing boats. I used to love being on the water. I sacrificed that for the next 26 years of my life, just because of one decision I had made. Mm. Mm.
So it was almost guilt about the decision you had made.
Correct. Mm. Yes. And as a man, you do not cry. You do not cry. That is very false, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
If I had cried, it would change many things. Just by crying and sharing with my wife meant that we lived a friendship life from that moment onwards rather than a hateful, angry life together.
So, Angelo, so after you entered the spirit world, your old friend who treated you like his long-lost brother...
Mm-hmm.
Obviously mentored you, he helped you come to terms with life in the spirit world. What kind of, obviously he was connected to God, this man.
Yes.
And this had a great influence on you.
Yeah. You could just see his face.
Yeah.
And you knew he was connected to something that I was not.
Yeah.
He didn't even mention the word God in our initial conversations.
Yeah, yeah. So what happened in that initial phase once you got to know him? You were inquisitive, you wanted to you asked questions. What were the kind of questions asked?
The first question I asked him was, how could he love me?
Yep. Because you didn't do enough to help him.
I didn't do anything to help him. Otherwise, I would have kept him on my boat.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't have let him go to shore even.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I said, how could he love after what had happened to him?
And what did he say in return?
He simply said that they did not understand what they were doing. Mm. And if they had understood that love is stronger than pain and revenge and control, and that the reason that they did what they did is because they were terrified in themselves. See, even to the fact that they had them in chains, they were terrified of these men.
Mm.
And so he actually saw initially that that we were the weak ones rather than himself.
So after you arrived in the spirit world and you sort of were reintroduced to love in a way, that's really what happened.
We had to start at the beginning.
Yep. Yes. How long did it take you to come to terms with some of the things about love? Like, was it just a simple matter of going, oh yeah, I realised I was out of harmony with love there and let's move on? Or what actually happened?
As an Italian man, there's certain things that were very easy. But when it came to a woman and how I treated women generally, that took a long time.
Right. When you say a long time, if you can compare it to Earth time?
Well, for me... within the first sphere where I was, it took 36 of your years for me just to open up to how I had treated women in my life.
Right. Yep.
Yes. Whereas I already had this guilt and shame around certain things that I'd done in my life.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't take more than a couple of years.
Because they were things you already knew that you'd done wrong.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Whereas the women relationship, you didn't know that you'd done anything wrong.
No, well, see, even how I was married, I didn't choose my wife, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
It's strange because it wasn't an arranged marriage, but it was.
Mm-hmm.
I was a seaman. I was very rarely on land. And then my parents basically said to me, this will be your way.
And after you had dealt with the women issue in the spirit world, so for that 36 years later, what did you start to notice then inside of yourself?
I noticed within my body, my spirit and soul, then that there was a caring for that I hadn't had before.
Mm-hmm.
So we see love as love, but there was a part of myself that had never actually wanted to love the opposite sex as an equal, as someone that I wanted to embrace and share with me.
So after that, what then happened?
Well, after that,
So was that the time you entered the second sphere?
No, I still stayed in the first sphere.
Yep.
It was 126 years before I arrived in the second sphere.
Right. So it took you 126 years to to go through the lessons of the first sphere, if you like.
Yes. And within the first sphere, as I went through the lessons, then I was able to discover more things in the first sphere.
Mm-hmm.
And every now and then, I was given the opportunity to see what happens in the second and third sphere.
Yep.
But I was not able to stay in those places.
When you say you were given the opportunity, spirits lent you the power to just visit those places?
They showed me. I was able to go and visit.
Yep.
Mm.
Yep.
Yes.
And that then increased your desire, did it, to...
It was like knowing that the more that I open myself up, that the more that I'm going to learn about myself. And I never went to school.
Yep.
And the spirit world is such a discovery.
Pretty big school. Yeah.
It's so exciting to be able to learn all these things that I didn't know about when I lived.
Mm-hmm.
So I stayed in the second sphere a long time.
So you basically arrived in the second sphere, what would have been about 1700, late 1700s would have
correct.
Been
in yes.
our time. Mm. And then you stayed in the second sphere for
another 100 years.
100 years there too.
Yes.
And what kind of things did you learn about there? That
well, I was fascinated about the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And in the second sphere, you have like libraries all around you.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that happens in the spirit world is the second sphere can become too comfortable for you.
Mm-hmm.
You can lose desire to want to discover more. You're not in any pain. I was not in any pain. My body felt good. I felt okay.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was there, I didn't need to keep looking at these emotions that I had as far as wanting to discover a soulmate or even open myself up to the possibility.
Mm-hmm. So you became very involved in intellectual pursuits.
All intellectual,
mm-hmm.
yes. And that's why I had to stay there so long.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm. And what caused you then to get out of that?
My mother.
Your mother. What effect did she have?
She came to me one day and said, Angelo, you're a nice boy.
And you said, I know that, Mum.
I'd been in the spirit world a long time at this stage and she's still calling me a boy.
Yeah, yeah. It's a bit rough, isn't it?
Bit rough.
Yeah.
And she said, Angelo, you always wanted to become a man. If you want to become a man, it's time you let go of some of these beliefs that you have.
And what beliefs were those?
Starting with the fact that women aren't here to serve you.
Yep, that's a fairly big belief you would have had.
And she said, if you open yourself to the possibility with friendship, this will start a new journey that you can't even imagine.
Yep.
So then, from that point onwards, I started interacting with women in the spirit world that I had not even done to that point.
So did you even see many before then?
No.
No?
No. I had no desire.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So you started interacting with women, and what did you learn through that process?
Well, I learned through that process that when you're with a woman in the spirit world, that you see things with the woman. And I could see that I didn't have a match with the women that I was with.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you had basically a series of relationships. Was that how it worked out?
To start with, yes.
Yeah. But with every relationship, there was a degree of dissatisfaction.
Correct.
Right.
Yes. There was no holding of the love.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. It was like a short desire that was fulfilled and then gone.
Yeah. So what then caused you to move into the third sphere?
Mm. When I opened up here.
Yeah.
Mm. And I started to look at where things went.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. And there was a chord that I was able to follow into the third sphere.
A chord? You opened up your heart.
Yes.
And then you noticed this chord linking your heart.
Yes.
To something else.
And it was a lady in the third sphere.
Right. So why is a woman? That leads you.
But do you notice that she was in the third sphere before I was?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So she had obviously opened up her heart.
She had.
She had
opened up her heart to me.
Yeah.
And she had known about me for 200 odd years.
For 200 years she had opened her heart to you without you responding.
Without me responding.
Mm. And what was her name?
Mm. Gloria. We'll call her Gloria.
We'll call her Gloria. Yeah. Okay. So you sort of felt the draw from Gloria into the third dimension.
Yes.
And in that process, what happened? You opened your heart, and that would have meant then you became a lot more emotional. Is that how?
I opened my heart, and then I went straight back to the first sphere.
Okay. Yeah. And what did you have to learn in the third sphere? In the first sphere.
There was a lot of grief.
Yeah, so a lot of crying that you had to connect with.
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. So you connected with the tears and cried. And
then I'd be straight back to the third sphere.
Yeah. Mm. So it went like a yo-yo for a while like that, was it?
Mm.
Back and forward between the second and first spheres and the third sphere.
It'd be like we're in conversation and then I'd suddenly be somewhere else.
So we'd be talking and it's like you jumping over to somewhere else in another part of the world all of a sudden.
Yes.
And wondering why you're there. Did you wonder why you were there?
Mm. Or it was pointed out to me many times.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm.
And then once you released that emotion, you went back to...
Well, every time you release that emotion, when you go back to your other half, it's stronger.
Yep, so you had a stronger connection?
Yes.
Yep.
And you discover other things that you did not know before.
Yep.
So every time I released something, it's like I saw more.
Yep. And therefore had more understanding and all of those kind of things.
Correct.
Yep.
Yes.
So you entered the third sphere about what time of our time here on Earth?
1830.
So we're now talking a couple of hundred years after... or just nearly a couple of hundred years after you passed.
Yes.
Yeah. Or is that right? Because you were. When did you actually pass?
I passed in 1662.
Right. So we're talking about 180 years after you've passed.
Yeah.
You entered the third sphere, and.
And when I entered the third sphere, I was going backwards and forwards.
So sort of jumping back and forward depending on what emotions you had to deal with at the time.
Yes.
Yep. So what happened after then? Like what caused you to discover God?
Well, I knew that there had to be something that was doing this because it wasn't me and it certainly wasn't my partner.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I met someone who was able to share with me the laws of God.
Yep. Did your soulmate know those laws?
No, she did not.
She hadn't learned them either?
Mm. And when we were when we listened to start with, there was no mention of God, simply the laws that operate in the spirit world.
In the spirit world, yeah. So you started to learn about what law caused you to jump back to the first sphere when you had an emotion.
Correct.
Yep.
Yes.
And laws about the heart, you started to learn some of the laws about the emotions.
Yes. And it was very important that I did not know about God first for my own opening.
Yeah. Why was that? What would have happened there if you had known, do you think?
If I had just gone straight into wanting the desire to connect to God, mm-hmm. I would have left out these big parts of myself that needed to be addressed first.
Right, so you would have probably tried to intellectualize your connection with God.
I would have stayed in the sixth sphere for a long time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
By allowing myself to look at how I love myself and that what was happening around me was because of my interactions was very important.
So when you started to be introduced to God's laws, what effect did that have on you?
I got so excited.
Right.
It was a relief.
Yep.
It was a relief. And I actually just cried about that for a long time. Yep. It was such a relief because many of you have a feeling every now and then that comes over you as if someone's there for you, but you can't be brave enough or you're not brave enough in that moment to want to discover who that is.
Yeah.
Mm. Yep. I got that braveness in that time.
Yep. So we're now talking about sort of the mid-1800s in terms of Earth time, and we're a couple of hundred years now since you were on Earth.
Yep.
And then what? So what happened after that? Was it a slow process, or
no,
did you still find
very fast?
Very fast from then on.
Yes.
And did you find yourself just flicking back, dealing with an emotion, moving forward each time? Now
that still happens now.
Yep.
So now I spend a large part of my time in the 15th sphere.
Yep.
But I regularly go back to the 13th and 12th sphere.
Yep.
And that's mainly because my lady is there.
Is there too.
So Gloria is in the 12th, 13th sphere.
Yeah. So she took a bit longer to discover God's laws, did she, and therefore have an interest in God, or what happened there?
Mm. Well, her block, even now, is she sees God as being responsible for injustice.
Right.
And she finds that even now, that's the one thing that she's continuing to work on.
Yeah. So if she is in the 13th sphere, then surely she's at one with God. So how could she then see God as a source of injustice?
Well, she sees the earth and what happens here.
Yeah.
And she finds it confusing often for her.
Right.
Of why we continue on earth to do what is happening.
Yeah.
This lack of love on earth.
Yeah. So she has the love in the spirit world, and she can see the love in the spirit world.
Correct.
But
she
there's
can't
a bit of
see the love.
So there's a bit of emotional confusion about the earth and what and what's going on the earth.
Correct.
And why it seems to be different.
Yes.
Yep.
She finds that is where she's discovering parts of God, like within the laws. We're taught simplistically the laws.
Yep.
And then you have an opportunity to actually understand the behind what is in the law, so to speak.
So a lot of the people here on earth wouldn't understand that a lot of the truths they've been presented with are not truths that you're often presented with in the spirit world until your development is quite advanced.
Well, in the spirit world, you generally don't want to know.
Mm. Because you're reflecting your real feelings rather than just what your thoughts are.
And especially in the lower spheres, most in the lower spheres have this belief of injustice, of how could this be happening to them?
Mm-hmm.
What did they do wrong to be in the place that they are?
Yeah.
And most aren't open to hearing that.
So when did you end up, I suppose we're now mid-1800s, there's quite a bit of time between mid-1800s and 2000, from our perspective at least, here on Earth. So what happened during that time? You had quite rapid progress. When did you actually become at one with God? When did you enter the gate of heaven?
That one was about 1926.
1926, so now it was, so you'd progressed from this time from the third dimension to the eighth in a space of around about another 100 years. Is that correct?
So what happens is by spending the time in the third sphere and going back to the first sphere regularly, And opening up to those emotions that I had, it meant I was able then to progress very quickly.
Yep, in comparison to before.
To before.
Yep. So in 1926, when you entered the celestial heavens, what did you feel at that time? I know it's very difficult to describe it, but...
The first feeling that I had was that I was finally home.
Right. Yep.
I had finally come home.
Yep. And you were welcomed by many spirits, yeah? Mm-hmm. Like everyone is. How did you find that transition? How did your spirit friends help you make that transition over that gossamer bridge, so we call it, mm-hmm. into the heavens? Like,
you have to go from trusting yourself and being responsible for yourself just to allowing mm-hmm. God into your heart.
Mm-hmm.
And the moment you allow God into your heart, you're no longer having to do it yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the big block that I had to getting through the bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Allowing myself to open up to the fact that I don't have to be doing it. Because
mm-hmm.
I could love and I could share. But then when you're opening up purely to God, it's very different.
Mm. Yeah. So from that point in time, in the mid 1920s, what have you been mostly involved in doing since then?
Well, in 1926, it was a very tragic time on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very busy time on Earth. So from 1926 to 1946, I had a desire to help many people that were involved in the wars
mm-hmm.
on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And that took many different forms.
Yeah.
So some of them... We probably should go back a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So when you arrive in the spirit world, within the first few moments of arriving in the spirit world, God gives you an opportunity. You have another chance to decide or change or feel open to other possibilities. So when many of these men especially arrived in the spirit world, they were given an opportunity to be shown another way that they could be engaged in the spirit world.
So you mean the men who were involved in wars?
Correct.
Yep.
Yes.
Yep.
And so most chose not to.
Right.
But many also did.
Yeah. So you would have enjoyed that process of being able to help them and educate them.
Correct.
Yeah. And
many of them were boys too.
Yeah, of course. Just under 20, many. Mm. Yeah. So after the war ended, obviously there were less people now passing into the spirit world than before. What did you choose to do then?
Then I went on a discovery for myself.
Right. Yeah.
And that was when I really wanted to understand God's universe as a complete.
Yeah. So when you made the transition, when did you actually make the transition between the 14th and the 15th sphere?
That was in 1986.
Right. And what was the major change in your being when you made that transition?
It was my desire to want to know more.
Yeah.
And so where I was, by opening up to this desire, it allowed me into another sphere of discovery.
Yeah. Mm. And in that case, a lot of new things were added to you.
It was like you talk about your computers, going from a slow computer to the fastest computer ever.
Mm.
Each time you go up to a sphere... So my discovery was the turning point.
Yeah. So how long now? So you've been in the 15th dimension for now since
1986 to now. I've been going between the 15th and the 13th.
Yeah. And when did you decide you wanted to be Peter's guide? What happened for you to be Peter's guide? Because that was obviously an assignment of some kind.
Yes. With Peter's guide, there's much confusion around how guides work.
Mm-hmm.
So many of you in the audience think that if I'm Peter's guide, I'm constantly with Peter. Beside Peter.
Yeah.
And I'm here all the time.
Yeah.
Mm. It's not like that.
No, when you're in the 15th dimension, you can share yourself amongst lots of people simultaneously.
Correct, yeah. Yes. So the main time I came to Peter was 3 years ago.
Yeah.
When you arrived on the scene.
Yeah.
Mm. So it was that time that Peter had a desire to want to discover more.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that's when he was assigned myself.
And obviously there are personality similarities between yourself and Peter. So yes. What are those?
The discovery is the main one.
The desire to discover new things?
Yes. Mm. And when I was on Earth, I had many desires as far as with land and sea,
yeah,
and understanding.
Yeah.
Very similar there. And also, Peter has a discovery or desire to want to know people.
Yeah.
And now I get great enjoyment out of just knowing people.
Yeah.
You, as many of you in the audience, you see all your hardships as that's who you are, whereas we get to see you as you really are.
Far removed from that person that often people believe themselves to be.
Correct. Mm.
Yeah. Yep. So when did we first meet? You and I.
When did you and I first meet? Mm-hmm. It's probably more the other way. When did I first meet you?
Mm-hmm.
That was about 14 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Yes. And I met you through another celestial who took me to meet you.
Before that time, did you realise that there was any of the 14 who had returned to Earth?
Mm. In 1930,
mm-hmm,
it was then that we were becoming made aware that it was a possibility that this might happen.
Yes, so you're aware that it could happen.
It could happen.
Yep. And when did you find out that it had happened?
Well, when the 14 years ago, that was the first time I had seen it for myself.
Right, yeah, gotcha.
Or right. I saw you for myself.
Yeah.
And your lady.
And lady. And the others too. Yep. Okay, so shall we just hand some questions out to the audience again and... Matthew, thank you.
G'day. Yeah, I've just got a couple of questions, Angelo. The first one is like, for me, and I probably feel like a lot of people who are following the teachings as Jesus and Mary are giving them, that receiving God's truth is probably associated with a lot of pain. Would you mind describing like a little bit of the process of longing for and receiving God's truth when you no longer have any pain?
Mm.
Like what that's like in the celestial kingdom?
Mm. Well, that word pain is a bit like the word death.
Yeah.
See, if you just went with desire, the pain, you're never going to have too much pain. Do you understand that?
No.
If you were just going with desire and love for yourself in that moment, the pain is never going to be too unbearable. Your desire and your love's always going to override the pain. Because every time you have an experience and you feel pain, it's what happens after the feeling. You know that the pain is so worth it.
Yeah.
So, no, if you can no longer see it as pain, the word pain, it's like, it's hard. It's going to be hard. It's going to be work. I'm going to have to fight it. The truth is, if you're feeling your emotion, there's no hardness to it. You're simply in that state rather than being up here. Is that any help?
Yeah, a lot. Thank you.
Yeah, a lot of times, Matthew, we see pain as the more important thing, and what we do there is we forget the benefits of the release of the pain. So after a while you start seeing pain not as an impediment to your growth. You actually see pain as a welcome
part of the process of your growth?
You know, as you're feeling the pain, that you're getting closer to your desire.
The question was about what it's like, though, to receive truth without... Because it's true that as we're led by desire, we feel our pain as a matter of course, but it's still pain, isn't it? So I was interested in Matthew's question, which was, what is the experience like once you have no more injury in you to receive more? Because obviously now you're receiving more of God's truth, aren't you, as you progress?
I'm a bit confused.
Peter's confused about the question.
Yeah.
But Angelo's not.
No.
Because, I'm getting really confused.
Yeah. So, if I can just help Peter with the question. What Angelo was saying earlier was that the main impediment to a person's growth before they enter the condition of atonement with God is that they believe pain to be something that's real and tangible. They believe that pain is the reason why they can't grow. But that's not the reason why they can't grow. The reason why they can't grow is because of their focus on pain. They are focused on pain. They feel pain is more important than the benefits that come after you release it. And because they have the wrong focus on pain, before the eighth dimension, people are constantly focused on the pain that they're in, rather than on the pleasure that they have of releasing the pain. Does that make sense? So why Angelo brought up the pain issue is that before the eighth dimension, you were too focused on pain still. Your pain is like, it becomes a major part of your growth because you want to focus on it. You want to say how bad it is that you're experiencing this emotion. Whereas after a while, you make a transition into seeing that it's fantastic to experience every emotion, and it actually feels a welcome relief to experience every emotion, even though there is some emotional pain in the process. It's actually a very, very welcome relief to experience the emotion.
And in the spirit world, you know that if you choose not to feel the pain, instantly you've been taken away, taken out of that sphere.
Yeah, down to a lower sphere.
And often you might go from the fourth sphere back to the first sphere. You don't always go back to the third sphere. Do you understand?
So you instantly receive the negative feedback associated with your resistance to pain.
Correct.
Now, once you enter the atonement condition, what does it feel like then? And that's what Mary was asking. When there's obviously no more pain, so what does it feel like?
The feeling is that you're continuing to grow and expand.
Mm-hmm.
So every time you're connecting to God, there's this feeling of growing within your soul,
mm-hmm,
and understanding more of what's actually happening. Mm-hmm. So in the lower spheres, you do not have the understanding of what's happening as it's going on.
Mm.
Whereas in my state now, you actually have the knowledge of knowing what's happening in that moment.
So there's almost anticipatory excitement with every single thing you receive.
Yes. Whereas when I was in the lower spheres, I was simply taken and put there, not knowing in the moment why this was taking place.
Yeah. And not realising that it was because your soul's resistance to the pain, correct, that was causing you to go back each time.
Yes. And for myself, it was generally around two or three very specific emotions.
So what were those emotions, Angela?
Well, the first one was obviously the
women.
The women.
Yeah.
Yes. And then the second one was the lack of love I had for my father.
Right. So it was more like a resentment of your father, wasn't it?
Well, yes. I never saw my father as a father.
Yeah.
So I resented the fact that I felt my childhood had been taken away from me.
Yeah. And the third issue that you mentioned?
The third one was the love of myself. Yeah. I was happy to punish myself rather than feel love.
Right, so sort of self-punishment, you resorted to self-punishment.
Correct.
Yeah. Very common issues for many of us, isn't it? Does that answer the first question?
Yeah, absolutely.
What about the second?
I was just wondering how many people are now in the celestial kingdoms?
So... Firstly, I'd like to ask your reasoning for that question.
I'd say there's probably going to be an emotion under there. I heard Jesus say at one point that there's now 40 billion souls, or more than 40 billion souls alive. Mm. And I guess I'm just kind of like wondering, well, you know, what proportion of those people are in the hells? What proportion of those people are in the spirit world?
And Angela asked you why you want to ask that question.
See, the reason you're wanting to ask that question is that you don't trust God and the fact that God can look after everybody. See, if there was no one in the celestials, God can still look after everybody. Do you understand that?
But
so we're simply connected to helping you all as a messenger from God. But God can do that regardless of whether we are in the celestials or not.
Why is it though that there's all these people on the earth now that have the desire for, this is coming up for me earlier, like have the desire for the truth and the willingness and the humbleness, but they're not receiving the truth yet?
Because for many on earth, they don't want the truth around God. And they find it easier initially to talk to someone like myself rather than simply connect to God.
Yeah, I can't agree with your question at all, Matthew. You're basically saying that people on earth have a desire to receive truth, but they're not receiving it. And that's a physical impossibility. If a person has a true desire to actually receive truth, they will always receive it.
Okay.
So the question is based on an illusion that you have that there is a pure desire in many people and yet they're not receiving truth.
Okay. I think I heard you say something about it, but I must have really misunderstood what you were saying.
The reality is that every single person who has a pure desire to receive truth receives the exact truth that they desire.
Like straight away.
Immediately. Yep. Right? And if we don't, then the desire is not pure. And the issue that many on the earth who believe they're following the teachings of truth are that they are actually not following the teachings of truth. This is why they are not progressing. Does that make sense? There's this. Everyone on earth wants to believe in the illusion of progress. This is a main problem we have. We want to see ourselves as progressing, when the reality is we're not many times progressing. And the main reason why we're not is not because of anything external to ourselves. We want, unfortunately on earth, we all want it to be something external to ourselves. That's the reason why. So we say to God basically, I've got a good desire, why aren't I getting what I want? You know? And the reality is God's going back to us, well, I'm sorry, if you had a pure desire, you would already be receiving what you want. So that tells me that you don't have a pure desire. Does that make sense? That's what God is saying to us back, basically. You do not have a pure desire, because if you did, you would already be receiving what you want. And this is very important to understand. If we're not receiving what we believe we have a longing for the truth, and yet we're not receiving the truth, then it means we don't have a longing for the truth. We just believe we do. And that's a big difference to actually having one. Do you see the difference?
Yeah. Thank you. Yep. Thanks, Angelo.
We want God to take the pain away.
Oftentimes.
Yes.
Yep. So we want to experience less pain. Why? You're going to have the pain you've got inside of you and release it. You're going to have to experience it. So a lot of times what we want God to do is help us have less pain. But God says, no, I want you to feel the pain that's already inside of you, because nobody else can. So already we're out of harmony with the truth. So this is the problem that we have on earth. We are often out of harmony with the truth of how to grow. Mm. We just believe, we have a concept of belief in our mind, but we're yet to understand in our heart how to actually do it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And for yourself, Matthew, you still believe that God can't do everything.
So God can give you all the truth you want, but you have to be in a place where you're wanting it in a pure sense. The instant you are, you'll get it. That applies to every single one of us. Immaterial of who we are.
That's the law of desire.
Yeah, law of desire.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to go back.
You want to take a break?
Yeah.
Yep. You're getting a bit of a headache, Pete.
No, I'm just getting tired.
Yeah, no worries. So Pete's struggling now, so we'll have to just take a break for a minute for Pete and have a drink if we can. So I need to go to the toilet.
Me too.
And Mary does too. So what we might do is just have a 5-minute break where we go to the toilet, and then we'll introduce two more spirits to you, Timothy and Rachel. Does that sound all right? G'day. The first thing before we get started is I want to point out to you that channeling spirits, particularly spirits who are of a celestial nature, is quite a difficult task, and it's very dependent upon the condition of the individual as to what kind of information they receive. Now, with Pete's channeling, there was some inaccuracies in the information that Peter received, and I can describe some of those inaccuracies, but if we can just firstly discuss why the inaccuracy exists. Does that make sense? The inaccuracy mostly exists because of the emotional condition of the individual who's doing the channeling. So you cannot assume that what is coming out of the individual's mouth is 100% of exactly what the spirit is saying, particularly the higher the spirit's condition. So the higher a spirit's condition becomes, the more difficult it becomes to channel information to a person on earth from that person, that spirit. Now, in Pete's case, what was happening a number of times was that Peter lost some of the connection with Angelo, and there was an intermediary spirit that then relayed information from Angelo to Peter during those periods of time. And therefore, some of the information was not accurate. Because of the need for an intermediary spirit, the information also became inaccurate. And rather than perhaps go through what was accurate and what wasn't accurate, because that would take almost as much time as the mediumship itself, I would rather put to you that everything that is spoken through a medium, you need to take into account the condition of the medium. And unfortunately, many of you with regard to mediumship are not doing that. You're almost trusting every word that comes out of a person who's a medium when the person is claiming to channel a spirit of some kind, and particularly claiming to channel a celestial spirit or a spirit who's on the divine love path. You're trusting every word coming out of the mouth of the medium many times, but many times not understanding what's actually going on, and so therefore there is a wide variety of things many times happening. Now, what we're going to do on Thursday evening is be more pointed about what those particular things are that are happening. Does that make sense? So we're going to describe in a lot more detail on Thursday evening what is actually going on in terms of what emotions are going on, when the spirit is there, when the spirit is no longer there in the connection, what's actually going on moment by moment. It will be a bit challenging for those people who are doing the mediumship Thursday night to go through that process, but it will illustrate to you the difficulties of channeling spirits who are of fairly good development. Alexis, you wanted to ask?
AJ, what is the role of the intermediary? Like, what is that about? Because that's the first time I've heard of that.
The intermediary spirit?
Yeah.
The higher spirit can no longer communicate with you due to whatever emotion you were actually in at the time. And what happens is there's often many intermediary spirits in different conditions already lined up by the high spirit to continue communicating with you. And the hope generally is that you get back into the condition you were in just prior to then, where the higher level spirits can speak with you. So for example, let's say there's a spirit in the 13th dimension talking to you. He will often have a spirit in the 7th dimension lined up to one in the 5th and one in the 3rd and one in the, even if in the 2nd or 1st sphere, but on the divine love path lined up to speak through, just in case his communication with you can't be established. Does that make sense?
So
and that's about rapport.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so you're saying in this case, when the rapport breaks, he can no longer be close to you?
He can no longer be close to you because of something inside of yourself.
Yeah.
He's close in terms of space, but he's not close in terms of what he can teach you or what he can tell you. And so emotionally, he's quite distant from you. So right at the moment, for example, in this auditorium, many of you are completely emotionally distant from each other. Yeah. Even though you're sitting right next to each other, you are completely emotionally disconnected from each other for the majority of us right now. Does that make sense? Mm. So you can be in the same physical space, but at the same time be totally out of rapport with each other.
I see.
Not understand what even your next door neighbour is thinking, feeling, or expressing in any way. And it's exactly the same for a spirit. A spirit can be sitting right next to you, on the chair next to you, but be totally out of rapport with you because of the difference in their emotional condition and their condition in love compared to yours at that moment.
Right. So ironically, that would mean the intermediary spirit would almost ironically carry the same wounds as you, so he could communicate through that wound?
Correct. Often they do have the wounds, but they're learning through the process of how to release those wounds.
Okay.
But often they have similar wounds, and therefore what happens is there's a distortion of the higher spirit's communication through that wound. Mm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if I can give one illustration of in Peter's channeling. When I started asking questions about where his soulmate was and the condition that Angelo himself is in, Peter's emotions started kicking in then, and then we started getting inaccurate information. So Angelo is not in the 15th dimension, but this is something that Peter would like to believe is true. And also his soulmate does not necessarily have the injury that Peter described. Does that make sense? And so those particular things come about from some of Peter's feelings and Peter's feelings about the world and Peter's lady's feelings about, Eloise's feelings about the world being now reflected through Peter relaying the information.
So in this case, Angelo didn't lie, it just didn't come through.
No, Angelo is still telling the truth,
yeah.
Or attempting to,
yeah.
But Peter cannot accurately hear it while that emotional injury exists.
Okay.
Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So do not assume that the spirit is the person at fault. You understand? We must always assume that it's our own condition that is causing the inaccuracy in communication. Always. The spirit is very rarely, even if the spirit in a first sphere condition, is very rarely at fault in their communication with regard to what they believe to be true. It often doesn't get accurately reflected. So this is why many of you can visit a medium and they'll say, oh, this spirit's saying he's in the seventh dimension and he's this and that and this and that, but he's really in the hells of the first dimension. But he believes he's in the seventh, oftentimes. So the person who's doing the mediumship believes sometimes. So even the spirit doesn't believe he's in the seventh, but sometimes the person doing the mediumship would like to believe he's in the seventh, and that's why the person says all of those things.
And if we relate this to the loving use of mediumship, which is what we're to talk about today, I feel that it requires a lot of humility on the part of the medium to be able to be... Well, firstly, we need to be open enough emotionally that we can feel the emotions of the spirits involved. Because the minute that we can do that, then we very often get feedback that says, what you said is just wrong, or I have to step back now, or... Rachel is often so direct with me that she will say, I can't tell you the answer to that question because you don't want to know. We talked to her about the channeling that I did last time we were here with Michael, and she said, yep, that was... Michael felt satisfied that he could share his personality with the group. However, there was many more things that he wanted to say, but we were limited to a certain scope by your desire, you know. And that I felt the same thing with Angelo. I was sitting feeling some things that Angelo was feeling as well, but because of some of Pete's fear and like, oh, I've got to do the thing, and it got what you're open to, it got limited down to he could tell these things about his life, but there were other bigger things that he wanted to share as well.
So, for example, he wanted to share a lot about his feelings of compassion for people on the earth, and he was unable to do that through Peter today. He wanted to share about his discovery of God a lot more, but he was unable to do that.
Discovering God.
Yeah, exactly.
He was unable to do that with Peter today. So they are two very, very big areas that he would have loved to have shared more with you, but it's limited by Peter's feelings about those particular issues. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I'm interested, Mary, you said before, like earlier, that you feel the love of your celestial guide and you cry the whole time and go into grief. Because that happens to me with my guide, mm-hmm. and I just cry the whole time. So, because it's just so much love and so beautiful, I'm not, you know. So, I probably am not getting anything clear then if I'm in grief.
You're getting more clear than would have been if you weren't in grief. But the reality is, obviously, you're in your own emotions, and so therefore you can't accurately reflect the emotion that the spirit has. But that's a good thing. It's not a bad thing, because you're at least allowing yourself to experience the grief of being loved.
Yeah.
The reason why you're experiencing grief is because it's not about being loved. It's about the comparison between that love and all the other loves you've experienced up to that point. So then you connect to the grief. But while you're experiencing your own grief, of course, It is quite self-involved in some ways, like you're experiencing your own emotion. So it's very hard for them to then go. It's like if Mary started crying in front of you, and I go, but listen to this, listen to that, listen to, you know, it's impossible, isn't it, for me to then transmit things through her to another until the grief is calmed down to a degree.
Well, she just keeps sending me the love constantly, and I just keep crying.
That's good.
And I'm trying to talk. You know,
that's okay.
To get messages.
You don't need to talk.
Because it may be better just to cry and not talk.
Yes, not it would be better because if you just cried and didn't talk and you just cried and cried and cried it out, then you would actually be in a better space to talk after that.
Okay.
That's the reality.
And mediumship is not just about receiving information, is it? It's like in my relationship with AJ. We're not just having a mind discussion, are we? There's all this other stuff going on.
Emotionally.
And that, to me, is almost the core of the relationship, which is often why I'm more open to reflecting their personality than the specific messages, because I value that in the
emotional
connection.
Connection.
Yeah.
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 Me too, I think. Yeah. Thank you.
So when the explanation of the injury of Angelo's soulmate, which was incorrect about God being angry with God for being unjust, how does that come in? Is that an injury of the spirit who came in to fill in for Angelo, or is that an injury connected personally with Peter that was...
Firstly, a celestial spirit doesn't have that injury. So he was saying, if you think about the information, he was saying that his soulmate was in the 12th dimension, which is way above the 8th, and she still has the injury of how she sees things happening on the earth and feels that God is somehow unjust with what's happening on the earth. Now, the reality is a celestial spirit doesn't have that injury. So either that means that the spirit being described is not in the 8th, is not in the 12th dimension, or it means that there's something inside of Peter that's causing an inaccuracy of the information. Now, the highest likely cause of the inaccuracy of information is something inside Peter. Does that make sense? And that is always the same with every medium who's on the earth, unless that medium was at one with God. It's the more higher likely cause of any inaccuracy in the information is the medium themselves, and we need to keep that in mind at all times.
Thank you.
Does that make sense? So please don't feel that I'm condemning Peter here, because Peter's in the process of developing his mediumship and also developing his soul. So as he increases in his condition, his mediumship will have more and more and more and more clarity automatically. That's automatically going to be the case. And so we need to understand it as a growing process, not as something that I'm hearing a spirit right now and that means it's 100% accurate 100% of the time and it's, you know, I'm getting really spot on information all the time. That is not the case. And also, by the way, if we make that assumption, we don't understand the loving use of mediumship either. And we want to talk about that as part of this process. Once we've introduced the other spirits as well, we'll actually start to engage our spirit friends then in helping you understand the process of mediumship and what actually goes on during mediumship and why it's engaged, why God has allowed the process of spirits communicating with us, and what can happen through this process, what loving things it actually provides to us, but also potentially can provide to them. So we'll talk about it from both perspectives. Does that make sense? Yeah? If you have a mic. Thanks, Laura.
Miriam.
Yeah. I'm just a little bit confused about the connection, about mediumship in general, and that my experience has been, particularly being around more people here, is that often it's... like really the most mediumistic people seem to be people with really, really deep injuries. Often that's just been a feeling I've had. So how, like, if the more injured you are, the more likelihood there is that there's going to be unclear channeling?
Yeah, I can't agree that the mediums have the more severe injuries. However, there is a quality in the mediums that makes you feel that way. And that is, a medium generally is more open to emotion than the average person. And as a result of that, they are more open to their own emotional injuries than the average person. So the average person is very intellectually driven and so therefore very closed to their own emotional injuries. And as a result of that, they are also very closed to communication with spirits. And a person who is very open to their own emotions, injuries or not, is often very open to, therefore very open to the emotions of spirits, and therefore very influenced at many times by those emotions. So a person who is mediumistic generally has less blockages to receiving emotions from their external environment than a person who cannot do mediumship. So they actually have one less emotional injury than the person who cannot do mediumship, but that doesn't mean they're free of emotional injuries. In fact, many times they are full of emotional injuries, and just like any other person on the planet, but they are more open to the experience of the emotion itself and therefore more open to the communication. Does that make sense, Mary?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah. I suppose...
There's a fair bit of your judgment in that question, by the way.
Yeah, look, I get that.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I've just experienced a few times, particularly recently, where people channel supposedly their guides, and maybe it is uninvited, just almost on the street.
Yeah, a guide would never, without invitation, channel to another person, a third party, without the third party asking for some information.
Yeah,
so it's not their guide.
Yeah.
It's the medium themselves is claiming that it's their guide for some purpose. Mm. And this is something we want to address with the group on Thursday night. Mm. There is a lot of addictions occurring in the mediumship team at present, and we need to address those particular addictions.
Yeah.
Otherwise, there will never be any accuracy with mediumship.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. So I suppose I was just wondering about kind of a question of ethics or integrity with just some, you know, people just lying that my guide is telling me this right now when the person hasn't asked for it.
There's no ethics at all in that, and therefore highly unlikely that a celestial spirit would be involved in the process.
Yeah.
See, a celestial spirit is always ethical. They have learnt the truth about morality and the truth about ethics, and they are always ethical in every single dealing they have with every single individual. So if a person is channeling information uninvited to you, then immediately they are not channeling a celestial spirit, because the celestial spirit wouldn't ethically be involved in that process. Now, the person might be claiming, my guide saying this. The reality is it's not their guide saying this. It's some very dark, generally, spirit who wants to interfere with the relationship between themselves and the other person, or somehow damage the other person by criticising them or, you know, providing some untruth to the person. And this is happening very commonly.
Yeah. The thing is, sometimes it is the truth.
Sometimes it is the truth.
because
often they get away with saying the truth, but it's not said with any love, and it's certainly not said with any morality, so therefore it's not a celestial spirit saying it.
Yeah. I guess it has confused me a little bit, because I don't feel particularly mediumistic at this point.
Yeah.
And those who I believe are, or, you know, seem to be connected with their guides, come out with things to which to me are quite unloving at times, and it leaves me feeling I don't know.
I agree completely. Yeah. Many of the people who are so-called channeling their guides, who are meant to be celestial spirits, are not channeling their guides, nor are they celestial spirits, but rather they are quite dark spirits who are attempting to manipulate people, who are more trusting than they should be about the person in that process. The key with any person you're listening to with regard to mediumship is have a look at the medium's life. If the medium's life is a bit of a mess, then how can the medium themselves be really channeling some high spirits unless they are in a place in that moment of complete contemplation, prayer and connection with God, which is possible at moments of our life, and in moments we can channel celestial spirits when we're in that space. But to do so consistently would require some major changes in the person's life, morally and physically, changes in their life from a spiritual perspective with regard to love and truth. And so the reality is there are many, many spirits who are earthbound spirits who are looking for opportunities to mislead people on earth, and many of you are falling prey to those opportunities because of your desire to believe you're channeling someone other than them. Mm-hmm. Yep. And we need to address that. And there are ways that can be easily, you can easily see that that is actually occurring, if you're open to it from a humility perspective. And so that is something we would like to address on Thursday night with the group. The reason why we want to have this discussion generally is because we're recording it, is because there are many people around the world who are attempting to channel and to use their mediumship, but many of them are getting hooked up in the addictive use of mediumship rather than a pure loving use of mediumship, and therefore are automatically attracting spirits who are of dark condition into the mediumship. But unfortunately, they personally, the medium, are claiming that they're not that person, and then causing doubts in others about that particular, about that information. We want to correct that by actually going through this process of seeing what is the loving use of mediumship, when would our celestial spirits be involved in mediumship, and so forth. Many times there are claims being made that celestial spirits are involved in mediumship, and there is not a celestial spirit in sight of the person, let alone connected to the person. Does that make sense? Yeah. And we need to understand why that's the case. And this is part of why we want to have today's discussion. Yeah. And the reason why we want to involve some spirits in the discussion is so that you can start seeing it from their perspective, what they see surrounding the person, compared to what the person believes is surrounding the person. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And if we can start doing that, we can find out a lot of information about what's really happening.
Yeah.
Yep. If we go back there. If you keep your hand up, so Laura, that's it. Thanks, Laura.
Hi, AJ. My question is, in New Age thinking with a lot of this channeling, mm-hmm. they often call in an intention for a higher guidance.
Mm-hmm.
Does the same principle work with the divine love, where you can call in that higher guidance from a celestial spirit? Not that you'll get that celestial spirit, but can they block maybe a lower energy or a lower spirit from the channeling?
Well, firstly, let's look at the first part of the question, which is what happens on the natural love path many times with people who are channeling. Many times people who are channeling believe that they can put a sort of ball of protection around them and therefore only channel certain spirits in that particular space. Unfortunately, the type of spirit that responds to that request is usually in the first sphere of the spirit world, because they have no honour of a person's free will in the spirit world. And so what happens is you often have a barrier of spirits around you, but they're all first sphere spirits, and preventing anybody else from connecting to the person in that particular request. So many times the so-called request is of God, but the reality is the soul condition of the medium always determines the truth of any request. So if the sole condition of the medium is, I want to show off to you, I want to, you know, get some glory from you and attention, approval from you, and so forth, then the true request is not towards God, but rather it's towards a heap of spirits which will honour those requests. That, does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so this so-called protective barrier is being maintained, but it's not being maintained by God or any spirit of any development, but it's being maintained by often very dark spirits or spirits in the first dimension who have a very concrete set of belief systems and who will only allow spirits of the same kind of belief systems to communicate via the medium. And so it's often a very, very damaging process that's engaged. Now, in terms of our celestial friends, and any spirit, in fact, on the divine love path, they will always honour the free will at the soul level of the individual. So you can request for God's protection while you're channeling, but if at the same time you've got the request of, I want to get some glory and I want some attention and I want some approval and I want this neediness with this other person engaged and I want some sexual energy as well, then that's the prayer. That's what you're going to get. You're going to get spirits in those conditions connecting with you. So for any request of God to actually be enabled, we have to have it from our heart in a state of sincerity and truth. And this is where the majority of mediums on the divine love fail, in the sense that because they are not looking at their true soul request. They are just looking at this intellectual request that they have, and they're not feeling, what do I really want in this transaction? So what we see a lot of happening is what they want in the transaction is the person. Let's say Mary was the person coming to me for mediumship, and I badly want some approval from a woman. That's my real emotion. Then that's my prayer. I want approval from this woman. So what happens is now some heap of spirits come who are going to just say exactly what Mary wants to hear, exactly what she wants to hear, nothing that is going to challenge her very much. Exactly what she wants to hear. They'll put a little bit of truth in there so Mary thinks that the rest of it would be truth, right? And then Mary gives me this great big emotion of how fantastic the mediumship was, and then I feel really good and happy with myself, and isn't it wonderful? And now we've both had our addictions met, and do you think any celestial spirit was involved in the whole process? No, none of them were. The celestial spirit, of course, is looking at the process and going, well, how can we correct this process? How can we correct what's going on here? But unfortunately, because we are so heavily in this codependent addiction with each other, it's highly unlikely that we're going to receive very much direction from them in that moment as to what's actually happening.
Yeah. So you need the desire strong enough within your heart for the celestial spirit to sort of go, I'm blocking everything here.
Remember, desires can't be manufactured.
Exactly.
So many of you believe you can manufacture desires. When I say manufacture them, you believe that you can go, I want this to happen in this moment, when the reality is your desires are with you in every moment. So it's the desires that are with you in every moment that will have the most impact upon who is going to come to you. Does that make sense?
Yes,
now,
it does.
Now, there are moments that you can raise your condition by having extra faith, if I can give you some examples. If you've spent a morning praying and you've dealt with some emotions, you've did a bit of crying and you released some emotions about your mum, and then you read some of the R.J. Lee's material, the Paget messages, and that helped you feel in a really good space, then temporarily your desires and condition are in a higher condition in that moment. Now, in that moment, you have the potential to receiving different types of information in that moment.
Because the rapport is stronger.
Yes.
So it's not necessarily that the celestial spirit is creating some, it's not blocking other spirits, it's just that your own condition is more open to their condition. Celestial spirits will never impact on the free will of anyone. So that's our will. So if our will's totally not in harmony with a loving desire, they can't override that, but also they won't override the will of other spirits.
The other thing that will happen with a celestial spirit is he or she will not feed your addiction when you're in an addiction. So when you are in an addiction, in a previous example I gave, I'm in this addiction, I want approval from women, even if I was in a relatively good space where I normally could channel my celestial friends, in this moment, I'm not going to be able to channel my celestial friends because they will not wish to feed my addiction for the woman's approval. Does that make sense? They will, in fact, wish to confront that addiction and help me work through that addiction somehow. So many times, many of you have, in your private mediumship sessions, claiming that you're channeling celestial spirits, and many times they're not even a second sphere spirit that you're actually channeling. And because they use the words of divine truth, right, which is relatively easy for a spirit to do, all he's got to do is listen to you talk for 10 minutes or read a bit of your mind for 10 minutes and go, yeah, they like the word truth, they like the word love, they like the word free will, they like this word, they like that word, they like this word emotion. If I just trigger an emotion in them, if I like to use that, another word, and somehow get them to connect, I can say a whole lot of untruth to them and they'll believe me.
Thank you.
For you, Alexis, thanks.
Sorry for so many questions. I've seen around here, you know, in Armadale, people kind of like in a conversation, suddenly somebody's guide jumps in a conversation.
Yeah.
Now, is that fishy?
Or is it's not only fishy, it's not their guide.
Okay, so that's fishy.
Because it's impossible to be the guide, because the guide would always announce their presence.
I see.
The guide would also be looking at whether the people there really wanted to talk to them or not in that particular moment. And that would be a question. Do you want to hear from me? Like, I'm such and such. Do you want to hear from me? They would already have quite a lot of things going on. There would also be a feeling of love coming out of them in the moment that they say the thing that they're actually saying. Yeah. And many times, none of those things are happening.
Right. And yeah. My experience was, you know, there was a gathering recently at Miriam's place. And I think Dave was in a mediumship with another person, Rose or somebody. And the feeling was that I noticed there was this presence in the room. And it was very, I can't tell if it was very big or very pushy, you know? Like I was kind of mentally rationalizing, going, okay, well, there's this divine celestial spirit in the room, so maybe, you know, it's like trying to squeeze the sun in a living room and it's really intense, or am I just feeling something else where it's just a little bit like...
Celestial spirits are amongst the most gentle people that you could ever know.
Yeah.
They are never pushy.
Right, because the feeling I had was I was having a conversation with somebody else, and the feeling I almost had was I had to stop this conversation and listen to them, even though my desire was actually just to continue having a conversation with them and let them have their own thing.
Exactly.
But I didn't feel that, I guess.
Well, so if that's you didn't kind feel that, fishy. It's highly unlikely it was a celestial spirit, isn't
okay.
it?
Okay, yeah, I'm just trying to decode this a bit here.
So, but we can go through a lot of the actual events when we talk on Thursday night, because I feel... in this particular discussion, what I'd like to do is cover the general principles, yeah. And we've got the opportunity of having a few spirits import their ideas of what's really going on and presenting what they observe to you, and then on Thursday night we can discuss it in far more detail.
Yeah, thank you.
That'd be all right. Okay.
So, can we just clarify about? So we just said some feedback about Pete, but. And we talked then about how some spirits can't even connect to us in different states. But say for Peter, he has a desire to serve with his mediumship. Mm-hmm. But I'm just reflecting for both of us. So then fear comes up for us. Mm-hmm. And what happens then is the rapport lessens between our guide and us on Earth, where it might be stronger under different circumstances, say if no one else was in the room.
So when Mary and I are talking together, and Mary and we're talking to some spirits, often the connection is very, very good because Mary's not worried about you and what you think and what you feel. She's just connected to the person. Does that make sense?
So, but because sometimes that rapport is lessened, then sometimes an intermediary steps in to assist with that process. It doesn't mean that there's no Angelo in the equation. It just means that it's being filtered a little bit through some other people.
But also for myself too, just at the end where I said I've got to stop, it's like in that point I was tired, and you're not tired when you really are connected. So it's
exactly.
like you're I was trying to push it, and I knew then I just got to stop.
Yeah. And we can be tired for many reasons too. Like, so some of the reasons is that, you know, we're now trying to do something that isn't easily flowing. But it could also be we're tired because we haven't drank enough water. And when we're channeling spirits who are of higher condition, they burn up the moisture in our body very, very rapidly. And so we need to have a lot of water. So there's quite a number of physical reasons why we might be tired as well. Okay, well, let's meet. Shall we meet Rachel and Timothy?
Hello, brother and friends.
Shall we start with some questions or proceed?
Certainly, no. it is a joy to be here, and merely I wish to say that I do not... we do not feel that we will be happy to discuss our life on earth and after our passing and our many adventures in the spirit world, but we also feel sincerely that we wish to discuss this very important topic of the loving use of mediumship. And so
well, perhaps if you could give us a brief summary of perhaps your life, like within a few 10 minutes. I know that's very difficult for 2,000 years of life. and then perhaps we can proceed with what the questions about what you observe with regard to the loving or unloving use of mediumship generally on the planet, and then also what's happening with regard to many people who are associated with the divine love path.
Certainly. This would be our pleasure, and we will be guided also by your questions.
Okay, so perhaps if we could just begin with a brief summary of your life. How does that sound?
Certainly. Okay. This is Rachel, and I will speak predominantly today for the purposes of keeping things succinct. Timothy would also like to meet you all. However, at this point, the rapport is best with myself, so we will continue in this way. I lived in the time of the first century, and I was fortunate to know this brother and sister before you today. I feel that my life was a very fortunate one in that I came to know them both in this very special time on the earth, but also that I was able to begin to explore and develop my relationship with God while I was still on the earth plane. This was very rare for most people in this time, and for many people even still, you would agree. This most beautiful of relationships is often neglected as the condition of the earth sits in a lower sphere, and one where people become very engrossed in survival, what they perceive to be the needs of survival. This was the case in the time when I lived in the first century. However, I was the youngest of three daughters, and we lived in a rural area. There was no pressure upon me to marry because I was the youngest. I would care for my parents.
So normally in the first century, daughters would normally, if they were the oldest, they'd have to marry. And then if they were of the younger, then it didn't matter either way because you got to get them to look after you as parents. Is that how it worked?
In some ways, yes. It resembled this. There was some onus, because there was no males in my family group, it was seen as well that I should remain in the home with my mother. And as my sisters grew, each married, and everyone was most comfortable for me to remain in the home and care for my now aging parents. I was 22 and still unmarried when I was fortunate to meet you, brother. as you pass through our town. It was very rare in this time for any woman to consider God in any real way. Worship was the role of men, and in many ways we were to obey the men, and through this we were assured of our purity, of our worthiness. And so it was very unusual for me to be drawn to be in the company of these men who were travelling through our village. However, I was entranced, enraptured by the words that were spoken, and so shocked that I would be able to remain in their company while they spoke of such things.
If I can give a bit of background, in the first century, when men began discussing religious matters or matters about God, women were usually asked to leave. And so it was very unusual for a woman to be asked to stay and listen, or even be allowed to stay and listen.
So I'm remembering that we are required to be brief. So what occurred for me then was a deep change within my heart. I recognised what I now know to be a deep passion for God that was a part of my nature. And over the course of a number of months, I confronted many issues within my family home, and I left my family home.
Which would have been quite difficult.
This was quite an extreme measure for any woman to take. But amongst your group, as you will remember, there were one or two other older women who had not the ties of family or obligation. Many of them were widowed or outcast from society. I began to know them and recognise that perhaps my life, although it would be flying in the face of social propriety, perhaps my life could be led in a different way. And I left under the cover of night to join this group and follow and learn as best I could for the time that you remained on earth.
So how soon in my ministry, if you could explain how soon it was after I began to publicly preach that you met me?
I believe that it was 5 years after you began your public ministry. I tend to recall this in terms of the years before your atonement. Mm-hmm. You were but 1 year before your atonement.
Mm-hmm. So if you could just outline to people, perhaps, I know many of them have a misunderstanding about when I began my public ministry truly. So compared to when I became at one with God. So most of the time when I've been talking to the audience, I've been describing to them when I became at one with God. But I actually began preaching to people before then.
Yes, and we may say that after your atonement, things became far more public. But you were almost a boy in your early 20s when you began to talk of the truths of God with others. And you had decided to leave the the proper way of society at a young age. And at the time that I met you, of course I was unaware of that you were incomplete in this process of atonement, for already there was a deep magnetism from your soul. There was a deep draw to the issues of truth and love which you already displayed. I began to follow in this travelling lifestyle, and we were supported by others as we travelled, but also I worked hard. I was no a stranger to hard work, having worked to support the family, the workings of our household, as my mother had been ill in later years. And I suppose there are very many things I could say about this time, but I'm conscious perhaps that we should remain with the punctuating points, perhaps.
I think also, though, it's nice to have people feel a bit of your personality and nature in the process. So, yeah.
Certainly.
So basically, in summary, you met me when I was around 30 years of age, and I'd been already preaching for over 5 years after that time.
Yes, this is the case. And there is, for myself, I have a sense that, as I stated previously, that my life was a very fortunate one in that I came to understand many truths of God by simply sitting and listening on many occasions with you and observing the way in which you dealt with life and other people. I have always considered myself to be a person of integrity, and I learnt many more things surrounding the issues of integrity in the time that I walked with you, if you will. Of course, one of the major reasons that I am here speaking with you today is that I became a deep personal friend of your soulmate, Miriam, when she joined our group. She suffered largely with many other members of the group because of her past, and yet I found her... quite easy to love. Although our backgrounds had been very different, we shared a common passion for life, for growth, and for God. And these were things that I recognised in her immediately, while others saw many other damaged parts. I am laughing now as she cries, because I feel a deep sense of gratitude for my relationship with her. Although she would say that she owes me the gratitude. We became firm friends, and we spent much time together. During this time, I also met my soulmate, Timothy. When we first met, we did not recognize each other as soulmates. However, I felt a deep attraction to him. One of the reasons that I had not married was that I carried a deformity from birth, and I was not considered to be a beautiful woman in the day. Although I resembled Miriam quite strongly in terms of stature and hair colour, my face was somewhat distorted. And for this reason, I never regarded myself as an attractive woman, nor did I seek the company of men in any romantic way.
A lot of this stuff's emotional for Mary because she's still going through the emotions relating to our first century life. So,
okay. Okay, could you ask me, please? Cause
well,
just try to control it. Sorry.
So, yourself and Mary were very, very good friends. And you eventually met Timothy. You felt an attraction to Timothy. Did you feel that Timothy felt an attraction to you?
Not initially. He was a young man who was also drawn to study. He felt that he would be with you for a short time to study the teachings that you delivered. Mm-hmm. He was uninterested in me because of the way that I appeared. However, over time, a friendship grew between us.
And is this the same Timothy that's in the Bible that Paul travelled with?
Yes. Yes, and we had grown close. However, circumstances parted us. As you are aware, at the time of your death, Miriam was some months pregnant, and it was decided amongst the men that I should travel with her in order to accompany her to a place of safety. This was a time of deep grief and trauma for all of us, and Timothy and I were parted for what we saw was a more important cause. And so it was not until his passing, some many years following my own passing, that we were reunited in the spirit world.
Hmm. So, obviously, Miriam wants to skip over the details of your own passing, and perhaps we can raise that another time. But once you arrived in the spirit world, which was before Miriam arrived in the spirit world, what happened then?
For myself, this was... Oh, I'm sorry. I have to go and cry.
It's okay. You're going to cry. It's okay. Just switch it off there.
Yeah, it's off. I just want to...
Sorry, everyone.
I'm very prepared. Mary just needs to cry, so she would need to go and cry. If I can maybe describe a bit of what Mary's finding difficult to describe. Rachel left Timothy in Jerusalem, and she travelled with Mary and some men who had decided to travel to Egypt, where Mary gave birth to our daughter Sarah. And when Mary gave birth to our daughter Sarah, it was a few days later that the Roman army caught up with them in Egypt, and it was decided amongst the men that that Rachel would be left behind in Egypt, and they would secret Mary and our daughter Sarah onto a ship, and have them sail northwest. Cross to Malta, Cyprus, and then through to France. In the process, Rachel was was caught and tortured to death by the Roman army, and so she died within a very short period of time after just being left behind in Egypt. And Timothy was, of course, still in Israel, and so he didn't hear of her passing for some time either. So she finished up passing into the spirit world, and of course she was welcomed by myself and other people who knew her, and they had the opportunity to grow in the spirit world quite rapidly because she'd already had a strong desire for God on earth. And all through that time, Timothy was spending now... Sorry, I just got to have a cough myself.